Welcome to 1987, the 80s very own year of the apocalypse.
1987, the height of the decade of greed. In the city of London, it was me, 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 as millions were being made by Thatcher's children, the yuppies. Porsches, champagne and red braces were de rigueur, but the ultimate status symbol was the newfangled mobile phone.
Hello.
The economy was booming. Rich shop owners found new ways to blow their wad as the public were gripped by the consumer bug. For Britain, it was buy now, negative equity later.
You had your file of fax, your mobile phone, people were starting to wear neck suits. For the first time, you know, people really spent money in this country.
British sport was also buoyant. Roly-poly Essex boy Mike Gatting led England to victory down under to retain the Ashes, whilst back home, football pin-ups Coventry City held aloft the ultimate domestic prize. Yes, British sportsmen were the envy of the world. Well, except for the ones going to prison for tax evasion. It was an election year, and as a plucky, flame-haired Welshman prepared to go head-to-head with Thatcher, students everywhere took sides.
You can always do more for young people, but Red West has been a tremendous success.
Not to be outdone by the socialists, the SDP, Liberal Alliance, Democrats Party thing had their own surefire youth vote winner, David Owen.
For a more sensitive, caring government than this Conservative government, that would certainly not be very difficult.
Thatcher played the media like an oboe, rubbing shoulders with TV hero Mike Reid and that bloke off LOL.
It didn't get anywhere, and I wanted to say get a bit, so I'm very much on the threesome side.
She certainly was. It was once, twice, three times an Iron Lady.
You will have a marvellous party tonight, and you can clear up tomorrow, but on Monday, you know, we've got a big job to do in some of those inner cities.
I think what we're witnessing is an even greater abyss of division than that which we witnessed previously.
For the Conservatives, it was time for celebration. But just like all the best parties, somebody gets carried away.
The prosecution described how Mr. Proctor ordered a 16-year-old male prostitute to get undressed and to call him sir. You should not fight in class, Mr. Proctor told him. Take off your pants and bend over.
A wind of change was approaching. The decadent southeast was dashed by a big storm.
Earlier on today, apparently, a woman rang the BBC and said she heard that there was a hurricane on the way. Well, if you're watching, don't worry, there isn't. But having said that, actually, the weather will become very windy.
A storm so very, very big, it became known as the Big Storm. Britain finally woke up to the fact that AIDS can affect us all, and the rubber johnny was the thing to be seen in.
It's slipping, the rubber johnny slipped off my nose. It's come off, oh God, we've got AIDS!
As our own bearded Johnny Peddler's balloon burst, the world's stock markets crashed, and the yuppie faced extinction. For some, it was all too much. I'll show you a place. Driven mad by redundancy and bored by daytime TV, EastEnders Arthur stole the Christmas Club money and wound up in the slammer. But even he would have been cheered up by the year's saving grace pop music. Tonight we celebrate the top 10 big-haired blow-dried chart acts of 1987.
When I think about our number 10 act tonight, I'm reminded of three things. Firstly, a character from Minder, then a Great British River, and finally, a classic horse race. Yes, you know, don't you? It's Arthur Thames Grand National.
Yes, I have seen the meaning of life. I have seen God. And I said to God, God, why did you not answer my prayer? And she said to me, Terence, I did answer your prayer. I said no.
Every once in a while the tube does something to make everyone happy, and this is it. So you have to put down your baked beans, you have to stand up in your living room, you have to take off your vest because you're going to get so hot, because it's just the best singer you're going to see all year.
You know, it's like one of those rare moments in your career when everything fits together. He looked great, he sounded great. Nobody had heard a voice like his for many, many years.
What I can recall about that whole time was just the level of excitement that I seemed to be tapped into. Ooh, don't leave me now, with my head on my shoulders long.
Have I done something wrong for you to leave? For Terence, it was like, okay, I'm going to be a pop star, and this is how I'm going to do it. It's almost like you might have written a business plan, you know. And he did it.
When Terence Trent D'Arby appeared, it was almost as if he exploded from nowhere, and he was this alternative prince, really. And he had the looks and the style and the voice.
He wanted to kind of occupy the ground that Prince did, which was be hugely commercial, sleep with amazing-looking women, and be credible to all the hip guys in London.
In 1987, ex-boxer, GI and self-proclaimed musical genius Terence Trent D'Arby hit Britain like a bolt of erotic lightning.
At that time, I was living the dream of a 25-year-old man. I was playing cool guitars, I had my own studio, and really pretty girls were giving me their phone numbers.
Terence was incredibly good-looking. And a really a sexy mover, as they say. You know, he could dance really well.
You had people like Patsy Kensit who flew in out of nowhere and attached herself limpet-like to his magnificent torso.
Keen to share his expertise, Terence was quick to give us repressed Brits some valuable pulling advice.
You saunter over across
the crowded room.
The crowded room. When you see her looking scintillating, tantalizing, delectable, delicious. You go over to a glass firmly poised in hand and you say, sweetheart, you simply must tell me your name. Because last night, as I dreamt of you, I could only call you baby. Get up out of your rocking chair, Grandma! Nobody move! Nobody get hurt!
Despite threats to Britain's OAP community, music lovers everywhere wanted a slice of Terence. Record sales went through the roof, hitting 8 million in 87 alone.
I mean, Terence had star quality to burn, you know. And the album, not only that, it was fashionable in all the... in every single trendy paper, in every music paper, in every fashion magazine. It was a complete clean sweep of the board in terms of media.
I felt it was overrated. I thought my first record was overrated. I really do. I thought it was good. I thought it was a promise of things to come. I thought it was the very beginning. But it changed my life. And some in ways that I was very grateful for, and some in ways it just took me time to adjust to.
But with the world at his feet, the pop princeling lost the plot.
He was surrounded by strange, alien kind of life forms at that point who weren't giving him the right advice.
I just looked and I just thought, this is, you know, this, he's landed into a place where he shouldn't be, you know, he really shouldn't be. Because it's not going to do him any favours artistically, or it's not going to do him any favours, you know, just as a human being, you know.
Incredibly talented, but I think in the end his fatal flaw was that he started to believe his own hype.
It's all me, 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 and then a couple more me's after that. Time I'm sure will bring
disappointment in so many things. Unfortunately, Terence was allowed to write, play and produce his new album, Neither Fish Nor Flesh, which bombed.
The impression I got was that he just was convinced he knew it all, really, and knew the mechanisms of the business. And I don't think he did, you know. At that stage, he was a bit green, you know.
He thought to himself, I can do whatever I like. And there was no one there to stop him, because when somebody has sold that amount of records, no one is going to stand in their way.
He was in such a strong political position with his record company that, you know, basically, he could have said, I'm going to do a yodeling album, and they would have said, OK, you know. Hail, mighty Caesar, bring on the yodeling.
Well, maybe some yodeling would have helped. Trent D'Arby had produced a commercial catastrophe which quickly sank without trace. Salvaged here for your listening pleasure.
If there's pain in your heart, let it go. Sweet inside. It's like sometimes sneaking away from a candy store and you felt like you just got away with stuff while you were in there. They don't give you a manual. They don't give you a handbook. Rockstar's handbook does not exist. You know, expect these things to happen. Your education is by living it.
Misunderstood by the Haven masses, Terence drifted into obscurity, consoling himself with the fact that he's got a few bob and he lives in a Malibu beach house.
There's a saying that I heard growing up, the only issue with dancing with a bear is that you can't stop dancing when you get tired, you know, and that's the most apt description of that time in my life of believing that I was providing the media with what they wanted.
Quick question for you. What do I, Anthony Minghella, and our number nine act all have in common? Born on the Isle of Wight. That's a Bruce Springsteen song, wasn't it? In 1987, Level 42, fronted by unconventional bassist Mark Thunder Thumbs King, were dripping in pop booty, a long way from their rather earnest roots.
We always felt that we were coming in from the muso side of things, that we were quite serious players.
Level 42 were coming off that whole jazz funk fusion. I'm talking serious, Miles Davis, Herbie Hancock, jazz music with tinges of funk.
They bought a one-way ticket on a jazz funk odyssey with instrumental dexterity that attracted a huge underground following. But soon, the money-hungry 80s and their greedy, grabby hands gripped the band, and record company suits demanded hits, hits, hits.
Mark's comment to me at the time had been, you know, I'm fed up with being the world's best bass player, I want to be the world's richest bass player. And I said, I'll make you a millionaire before you're 30. Shook hands across his kitchen table and off we went.
New image, new sound. They'd hit the big time.
Our dad would send us to our room, be the voice of him. He said that we would thank him later.
Paul Crawford came in, and he now seemed to sort of fit more with the way that the 80s had gone as well. It was all flamboyant and sort of big suits, and their shoulder pads had crept in, and our hair was suddenly all big. And, I mean, it really is quite embarrassing to look back and see these things now.
There was a very conscious decision made to sort of embrace all of the things that typified the 80s, really. And that was sharp suits, it was expensive-looking videos, Rolex watches.
The key word was think Rolex. It's like when we're making the video for Something About You, the premise was, if we make a video that looks as though we're really successful and really rich, then everyone will think we're really rich and successful, and, you know, it will sort of like the Chinese whispers will carry on and on and on.
Suddenly, instead of just selling like 60,000 records, we were selling 6 million records, and that's a real big difference, you know, and consequently the money starts coming in. It's us Wacky Boys from Level 42.
Suddenly, Level 42 were pop players, their music increasingly in demand with the new CD generation.
You know, if you were a yuppie, it would have been something that you wouldn't have been embarrassed to have in your record collection. And also, it would have been quite hard to believe now, but it would have been quite cool to produce it and say, oh, here's the latest Level 42 record.
Yeah, it was Rolex and Cartier if you could afford them. Yeah, it was the decent CD player. It was Level 42 in there. If you're in a sort of solemn mood, it was Sade and those kind of bands. It was quality pop that we were looking for.
Okay, let's dance! This one's got hot water for the birthday.
Level 42's fans had swapped their white socks and Mark III Cortinas for Armani suits and BMWs. And they had an army of hip new admirers, including Princess Di and Glenn Hoddle. But the critics still weren't impressed.
I think there was something about Level 42 that was like, it wasn't good to be seen to be liking Level 42. You know, we weren't angry young men. We were sort of you know, all had fairly middle-ish class backgrounds.
I once was sent to the Isle of Wight to interview Mark Kingsborough of Level 42. And if there is a nicer man in show business, I've not met him. Let me give you an example. The taxi pulls up at this mansion, and he came up to meet us, and he said, you're just 10 minutes late. Never mind, I've just been nicely crisping. And I said, what'll be nicely crisping? He said, the pizzas. I've made us all some pizzas for lunch. So we get in, and he gets here, all these pizzas and a nice bowl of salad that he's made. Now, Iggy Pop doesn't make you a pizza when you go around to his house for lunch.
A nice bunch of Southern white kids, except for Mike, you know, like, who's just really got nothing to sort of, no axe to grind, you know. The bland eating the bland was sort of favourite sort of thing.
Bland? This? Still, not everyone was happy with the new direction.
Everybody was happy with the money initially, but certainly Phil felt that we were, quotes-unquote, selling out, that we had made, you know, we had sold the musical soul of the band in exchange for, you know, commercial success.
To play that sort of stuff live, it was like being in a holiday camp, you know, when I was 21, just having to play this grinding stuff. It's just no interest to you at all.
Welcome, Level 42. Yeah!
After an emotionally charged appearance on Wogan, guitarist Boone left the band, followed shortly after by Phil. It was the end of the classic Level 42 lineup. But I can see another road, and I... Today, with old differences settled and the occasional backyard reunion, it's pipe and slippers time for the rest of the band. And as for old Thunder Thumbs, well, what do you think? Damn.
And if they say four cheeses, I want four f***ing cheeses, all right? Good Lord, television, eh? It's not like it used to be in 1987, is it? Fresh, radical, slamming.
Consigning mere televisual trifles like talent and professionalism to the dustbin of broadcasting history, 1987 saw the kids take over television as youth TV was born.
This is a programme for young adults, made by young adults, and concentrating on all the subjects that young adults are interested in.
Dispensing with the Squaresville style of its early 80s predecessors, youth TV packaged hard facts into a style the kids could understand.
In a gas chamber, cyanide gas is released, and two charges of 2,400 volts are sent through his body, followed by muscle-paralysing liquid.
It's God.
Hello?
God, what is the meaning of life?
Well, that's a big question. It will take ages to explain.
That's okay, we've got 9 seconds.
Let's go back to the dawn of time. In the beginning...
Terrific, and when's the tour start?
Tour, there is no tour.
Right, so let me ask you, if you're so all-powerful, how come you allow so much suffering in the world? That's the question for the power. Here's yours. Where do you get your sock?
Take three legendary pop Bengalis, two girl singers from the East End, one chart-topping hit, and you get our number 8.
They were just girls out to have a bit of fun. They really were just into the fun of it all. They wanted to be pop stars.
The plan for Mel and I, way back when we were kids, were that we were going to sing together.
With Mel and Kim, you took nothing serious. They giggled all the way through. If you listen to the Mel and Kim records, there's laughter all over the place because you couldn't never keep Mel from giggling.
Brought up on the mean streets of Hackney, sisters Mel and Kim Appleby were always going to make it.
We were real streetwise, we really were. We were very sus. Two East Londoners were very, very sus.
Mel had been a topless model. Kim made knickers down the old Kent Road.
Pastry stunner Mel had taken her first steps into showbiz with the exclusive Glamour Girls Roadshow.
I got the idea of putting together a group of lesser-known models that maybe had appeared on Pastry into an actual show. which is how I met Mel.
She was very comfortable with herself and with her body. I don't think she had any qualms about doing glamour modelling. She was enjoying it. I mean, it's better than working in the rat trade, for God's sake.
We were in the studio recording Mel one day, and the engineer was joking and said to her, is there any more like you at home? She went, yeah, I've got a sister. And I said, well, can she sing? She said, yeah, she can sing.
Having recorded a demo for Al, the sisters were quickly snapped up by pop supremos Stock, Aitken and Waterman.
These two girls came up to me and said, here, you looking for any pop stars? Can you make us pop stars?
Aitken!
They were two lovely kids, you know, young and wild and uncontrollable and so excited about being in the studio. Just the way they were was what forced us, in a way, to make the records we did with them.
The guys, Stock, Aitken and Waterman, wrote the songs around Mel and I because we told stories from where we were coming from who we were.
The Hit Factory's newest recruits were an immediate sensation. But unlike many a paranoid pop star before and since, they made no attempts to hide Mel's page three past.
Respectable was written because, you know, we really just didn't give a shit about these pictures coming out. So they decided to write a song called Take or Leave Us, Only Please Believe Us, We Ain't Never Gonna Be Respectable. And it was perfect because it was so us. And really, really enjoyed singing that song. We had a great time singing that song.
To me, way Mel and Kim dressed and the way they came over, it was that whole kind of Saturday afternoon shop culture.
The whole thing was that you can be, you know, you don't have to have the money to be hip and trendy and do whatever you want to do. You know, you just, you've got to go for it.
Mel and Kim kind of reflected buoyancy that the 80s had. There was optimism. There was certainly, you know, there was an economy that was doing quite well.
You can imagine those two girls being every club you went to on a Friday night. There was 100 of them sitting there, all looking the same, all with the same attitude.
Turned to the guys, we went, FLM. And they went, yeah, and we went, well, what is it? And they go, fun, love, money. But FLM really means fucking lovely, mate. That's what it meant, because everyone would just walk around the studio and go, fucking lovely, mate, fucking FLM, FLM. So they'd written this song called FLM, and we obviously thought that it stood for fucking lovely, mate. But they changed it and turned it into fun, love, and money, which we thought was really good, it was really clever.
Another hit. But something was wrong. The sisters cancelled tour dates and didn't appear in their new video. In the press, rumours spread about Mel's health.
By this time, Mel was having back problems, complaining of back problems, which we thought at the time was due to the dancing, because we were doing so much dancing, and the schedule was a joke as well. We were promoting. I mean, there was just no time to stop. So she kind of soldiered on regardless until it got to a point where she couldn't perform.
She'd collapsed in a club in Tokyo, dancing. She just, the pain had been too much, she'd collapsed, they'd rushed her off to hospital.
It became really hard work, keeping it a secret, and hiding her from people, you know, because obviously she was bloated from steroids, she'd had chemotherapy, so she'd lost her hair. So when the news did break, it was a big relief, and we actually went on Wogan, just to put the record straight, to be honest with you, because there were so many stories out there, and we went on Wogan, which was great for her.
Oh yes, I'm leaving now, I've had enough. I'm tired of you going, struggling all yourself.
And I know that you... Mel and Kim were like my daughters. I mean, we had a very special and different relationship.
Baby, because I heard it all before.
Cause baby. I was in Japan and I got a telex that she'd died of pneumonia, you know.
it's the saddest thing that's ever happened to us in our professional lives, that we discovered Mel was seriously ill. You know, looking back now, their career had only really just got started.
They were the first girls on top. You know, they were the first girls to say, you know, chaps, up yours.
I say we were one of the original girl powers, to be honest with you. But we had balls, but it was real. It was raw. And, you know, it was fun.
Our next artist left behind the badlands of Watford, Vicarage Road, Watford Gap Services, for the exciting world of pop. Espadrilles, showbiz parties, T-shirts, great big words on them. By 1987, he dumped his partner, dumped his razor, and reinvented himself as a serious solo artiste.
Permanently tan, fun-loving pop monkeys Wham had been unleashing their unique brand of Playboy pop since 1982. In four short years, the band had helped transform young Georgios from this to this. But he knew it was time to split.
Well, the check's in the post, is it? Look, Andy, how am I going to get this into your thick head? That is now George Michael writing, producing, playing and singing George Michael songs. I don't regret a single
moment. No, I don't. All their people knew the band had gone as far as it possibly could, and it was time for George to strike out on his own.
Before going solo, he had just enough time to snap off a quick number one with Aretha Franklin.
George had grown up. That's all that had happened. They were really, really young when Wham launched, and he grew up.
Farewell then, bouffants and shuttlecocks. George was getting down and dirty.
He went quite deliberately into a much more racy image, much more deliberately sexy. There he was cavorting with this model and simulating sex scenes and deliberately going out to be very provocative.
The first thing he wanted to do was kick the solo album off with a bang, and excuse the pun, but he did.
The desired effect was achieved as frantic TV and radio executives pulled the plug on Georgie Boy's filthy antics.
It was known from day one that this was a record that was going to be banned left, right and centre, that the mood of the world at that point with the AIDS crisis meant that it was going to be frowned upon.
I Want Your Sex is Let's Get It On by Marvin Gaye, but updated for the 80s, and it's a cuddly version of that. You know, anyone who truly thinks that that is kind of a threatening version of sexuality is off their rocker, you know.
There was this rumour that he was engaged to the model in his I Want Your Sex video, and he went all out to present quite a macho image, really, but in a way that was all over-egging the pudding, and it was still quite camp.
There's an ambiguity about, you know, were they going out together, what was their relationship, and I think, he, you know, that's the side of him that he kind of enjoyed playing with the public, you know, and I think it's, it's no deeper than that, really.
George was certainly sending out some confused messages about his new image.
The sniffing of the armpits on the sleeve of the album, what he was saying was, I'm not a contrived, manipulated production line popster anymore. I'm raw, I'm earthy, I'm raunchy, I've just had sex with a woman. Maybe it was a man, I don't know.
A lot of people responded to the graphic look of I Want Your Sex, so with Faith we decided to kind of take that a stage further.
If you look at the Faith video now, that is the 1980s, encapsulated in a nutshell. You've got the blonde highlights, you've got the distressed denims with a bit of the bleach stains, You've got the leather jacket with the sleeves rolled up.
The Ray-Ban aviator specs, the pointy cowboy boots. This was a cross between James Dean and the Marlboro Man, and it really set him off well. Baby!
That was what people looked like in the suburbs of London throughout the 1980s, and it's a ghastly apparition.
The bristly new look impressed record buyers stateside. George picked up numerous awards and clocked 4 US number ones from Faith Alone.
He was going after the American market, partly at the expense of some of the British fans who couldn't quite work out what had happened to their pin-up, who'd stopped being this bouffant-haired Diana look-alike and had now gone off to be someone else.
American audiences don't like manufactured pot. They like blue-collar. They like Bruce Springsteen. They like working men. And this is what George Michael was saying to people. He was saying, I'm a real person. I'm not a puppet anymore. Look at me. I'm drenched in body odour. Isn't it fabulous?
George had created a leather monster and struggled to shake off an image the fans loved.
It was just too good. They identified with it immediately, so much so that he found it very difficult later to try and get rid of that image.
In his video for Freedom, you can already see the first elements of his dissatisfaction because he goes through the symbolic gesture of the burning of the jacket.
I think it's quite interesting in Freedom that they burnt the jacket, blew up the jukebox, which is a very interesting kind of concept because he was not wanting to be in his videos at that point, which is later on. So he's destroying the image that he'd created.
The idea of being a chameleon and changing image, you know, he did that. I mean, he, in no spectacular way, but yeah, he went from Teeny Bopper to Mr. Shag Merchant with the stubble and the ludicrous hair to the Greta Garbo of funk pop. You know, he totally retreated into a darkened room and he stayed there for several years, and I think a lot of people were quite glad about that.
Essex has given the world a vast array of musical talent. Billy Bragg, Blur, Ian Dury, Depeche Mode, Dr. Feelgood, Alison Moyet. Not a lot of soul bands there, though. Whose job was it to export Essex soul funk fun to the world?
America had the Jacksons and the Osmonds, Ireland had the Nolans, but at home, the family-based pop combo cupboard was bare. Until... Take a look at me.
British music industry didn't have a family unit. Of course, America had their own, the Jacksons, the Osmonds, so on and so forth, but I think that was the only thing that was very, very different about Five Star.
I think it was a thunderbolt of something so fresh and so great.
They were the closest we could get to an American sounding R&B act.
They did it in true style. I mean, these, as far as I'm concerned, this family were living in Hollywood. They weren't living in England.
Shacked up in an Essex two up, two down, for the all-singing, all-dancing Pearson family, tea time was a laugh.
Doris was a natural dancer, so she became the choreographer, choreographing our first song.
She has this wonderful sense of rhythm.
Naturally, Denise was the lead singer, so she's pretty much the vocal arranger of the group. I do most of the interviews because I talk too much, I talk a lot, so I'm here.
And then of course you've got Del with his musical ear.
Instead, having a natural background of designing, became the designer for the group. He has a great eye. Oh, you can
never forget. Equipped with Stedman's eye, Delroy's ear, and Denise's purting mouth, Five Star took the first tentative steps along the golden path of pop. Always lurking in the background, their dad, manager and mentor, Buster.
They were so closely managed by their father, Buster Pearson, to the point that the kids weren't allowed to go out together, they weren't allowed to be seen smoking or drinking. They were almost like some weird religious sect.
My father had this vision for us, that helped put us on the map. He was the one that was sort of like knocking on the doors and you know, telling everybody, look, this is what I have, this is a product here.
When I think they did well as a family unit, to keep it together as a family unit in the way that they did, he was managerially well on the case, and he took them all away.
At the time, 1987, their album was the biggest hit-making album of all time. They got 7 hits out of 1 album. By anybody's standards, Beatles, Rolling Stones, whoever you like, that is some going.
Funny, but they had so many singles out one after another, it was like buying the album on HP. You know, these guys knew what they were doing.
It was hectic. There was a lot going on. There was moving house, there was making albums, there was doing tours.
It was such a dramatic change from going from ordinary kids to all of a sudden this sort of pop star status.
The money rolled in and Five Star rolled out of Romford. The Clampitts had become the Colbys.
Moving from Romford to Royal Berkshire, into this great big home. You had the beautiful cars and the great clothing, so on and so forth.
The house was sort of done in such a way that everyone had their own suite, a couple of bathrooms and a bedroom. Buster had a converted sort of study area where I remember the pile of the carpet wasn't deep, it was ocean deep, you know.
Well, the mansion was a kind of a monument to bad taste. I think if people have too much money, really, and have to spend it very quickly, there's a limit to, you know, to how well you can furnish something.
Spending too much? That's absurd.
But recession hit Britain tired of star pop, and the hits dried up, as did the money. Five Star and Dad Buster had blown £15 million in 3 years. The game was up.
He just fell too easily into the rock star manager mould. His financial control was absolutely hopeless, and the band just spiralled off into an appalling series of debts.
The mansion was repossessed, and the Pearson clan moved to LA to regroup.
Can't think of a moment that you were there.
Pop is notoriously fickle, and, you know, fans get bored after a time, and unless you're having really, really huge hits all the time, that's not enough to sustain you in later life.
I think what they did, they took themselves too serious, too quick. They had it, they were a great little pop group, and then suddenly they thought they were R&B.
13 years on, Five Star remain in Los Angeles and continue to make their long-awaited comeback. And the old magic is still very much in evidence.
Eyes don't lie, that's why. I know you're thinking of me, and I don't lie, 'cause I wanna make your dreams come to life.
No. Staggeringly, some people still failed to fall under Five Star's amazing spell. But to every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. The flip side to Five Star's cheery coin was this.
Can we have a burst of napalm death, please? People will tell you that 1987 was not a good year for music, but I thought it was fine. I got a lot of pleasure from Napalm Death, from Unseen Terror, The Stupids, Heresy, and a lot of others. And perhaps in a couple of years' time, you'll find that you'll be pretending that you liked all of these bands all along.
I might not, John. With the longer songs hitting 30 seconds and band names like Nuclear Assault, Morbid Angel and Death, thrash metal was the grim-faced alternative to late 80s pop.
To me, thrash metal was slightly more punky than the previous heavy metal, more serious as well. The apocalypse was in the air, and Slayer and Napalm Death picked up on that feeling.
Elsewhere in the world of provincial pop circa 1987, we have the Goths, a bunch of sixth formers spending all their pocket money on eyeliner, prowling the night till mum calls them in for tea. Harmless fun, but some took it too far.
Do you describe yourself as a gothic?
No, I describe myself as a vampire.
What exactly does that mean?
Well, a vampire. Here, you see a vampire. This is a vampire.
They say 80s fashion is coming back. Great news if it means more of this. But before you go digging out your sharp suits, stripes and shoulder pads, hold hard and please enjoy this homage to provincial pub rock.
Shrewsbury, home of Charles Darwin, Clive of India and Percy Thrower. In 1987, a new name became etched forever into the Shropshire Hall of Fame.
The birth of Tapao was 6 years in the making. It was a long labour. And I had, I lived in Shrewsbury in Shropshire at the time, and I was in a local band called The Lasers, spelt with a Z. Very important.
We were really happy in Shrewsbury. It was a, you know, we lived in a great place and it was good fun and stuff.
And we were the two sort of leading lights of the Shrewsbury music scene, you know.
I was the telephone engineer. Carol's working in shops and bars and anywhere we could make money, really.
After conquering the pub circuit as far afield as Mid Wales and Stoke, the Tapao were ready to bring the Shrewsbury beat to the world.
We go down to London. We have a huge posh lunch at 192, which is in, you know, Notting Hill Gate, dead trendy. And we sign our deal.
Success seemed assured. Their first single release flopped.
I found it in the bargain bin in a shop on the Kentish Town Road. This was our first release within a month, and it was a bit discouraging, to say the least.
Meanwhile, we'd had a simultaneous worldwide release, and Heart and Soul shooting up the US charts. I mean, it's galloping. So we re-release it, and eventually Heart and Soul went to number 4 in America, number 4 over here, and it went top 5 in most territories.
The key to their success was Flamehead Carol's raunchy look.
I was in there, cakes of makeup. I must have gone through 2 cans of hairspray, slaughtered herds of cows, so I got my shoulder pads right out here. Yeah.
If you were to go to a Tuesday night rock disco in Whitehaven, there'd be a lot of girls who look like Carol Decker from Tapao drinking Diamond White at the bar.
I was described by somebody who clearly didn't like me very much as I looked like a lighted match. But I did, I was just like this pale, skinny little body and all this mad red hair.
Tapao were hot. Their next release stayed at number 1 for a very long time.
It was a theme she had on a scheme she had, told in a foreign land. To take life on earth to the second birth, and the man was in command.
Don't push too far, your dreams are China in your hands. That was the catchphrase, that was the message. I think we can all learn something from that.
Don't push too far, your dreams are China in your hands.
Have you ever held a piece of real China and the cups have a little face in the bottom and you can hold them up to daylight and see through them and they're that fragile?
It's about Frankenstein, I think.
And you can, if you hold them too hard, they can break. And that was what it was, that China in your hand, not the entire country, which clearly nobody could hold in their hand, it's too big.
I don't know myself, to be honest. I don't listen to lyrics a lot.
Whilst Ron and Carol deconstructed the lyrics, the rest of the world wondered what the good Lord the video was all about.
In China in your hand, I had my messy bedroom, and all the stuff blew up, and that was like the chaos of my mind. And we had rabid dogs in it.
And they all had slow motion roses being broken and glasses broken and all that kind of stuff, which was that, you know, that's what happened in the 80s apparently.
But as long as I had a nice frock on and the gorgeous legs out and all my slap, you know, that's all anybody cared about really.
You're gonna shoot fire, dreams are China in your hand.
But success came with a price, as an over-eager fan once left Carol with a rather sticky situation.
Me and my wardrobe lady, Sally, couldn't find my tops. And we're looking, and Sally was quite tall, and she sees something on top of the wardrobe. It's my tops. Somebody had masturbated into... It was either an elephant or several guys. You know what I'm saying here?
While Carol hot-footed it for the dry cleaners, Ron was more worried about the band's direction.
We always thought we were just like a rock band, obviously we played pop music. But the public perception we know now is completely different, and they perceived us as just a pop band.
But the Pal, as we called them, could still turn it up to 11. Check this out.
It was more of an issue where I'd find myself doing magazine shoots or these gala performances with people, and I just think, we're a rock band. I should be with Bon Jovi or Def Leppard. I shouldn't be here.
We'd just do anything we were told to do, really. You know, do any photo shoot for any magazine or for any reason, which, looking back, is a bit of a folly, I think.
I always feel it was like a tornado. If you've seen that movie Twister, it picked us all up, and then it went, and we all went, like this, left with whatever was left of our lives.
Eventually, the band drifted apart as Ron and Carol went their separate ways. Ron headed for the hills and settled in Wales, while Carol has started a family, done a bit of telly, and briefly relaunched the Pal with a 90s version of Heart and Soul, which the record-buying public approached somewhat gingerly.
Berlin, Irving, you say? You got Washington, Gino, Hayes, Isaac. Isn't it funny how many showbiz greats are named after metropolitan centres? Windsor Davis, Dwight York, Dionne Warwick. Coincidentally enough, she's the auntie of our next turn. Brace yourselves.
Ah yes, Whitney Houston. These days a raunchy leather-clad den mother to R&B bad girls everywhere. In the late 80s, owner of the most celebrated lungs and hymen in pop.
Back in 1987, she was like a real virgin. She was untouched by human hand, and all vocal pyrotechnics, and look what I can do, Mum. You know, look, no hand.
For Whitney, it was quite a hermetically sealed upbringing. She was trained from an early age to perform. She did her first solo in church when she was 11 years old. And then from then, she was performing live.
Under the watchful eye of her mother, Sissy Houston, an Elvis backing singer, Whitney never put a foot wrong.
I had a mother who could sing, a mother who knew the business, a mother who could write, a mother who could produce, and a mother who could teach me everything that I needed to know. And I listened to her. I wasn't ignorant, and I wasn't rebellious or defiant. I knew that she knew what she was talking about, and I believed in what she said.
People are used to the idea of soul women being real divas and real gritty and earthy. Whitney was too sanitized, she was too clean, and it appeared to them probably that she had been hosed down and scrubbed up and put in a neat little parcel by the suits and the ties, as they say, of her record company.
When you hear someone like Whitney for the first time, for me, although it might sound cliche, you get that tingle up and down your spine. I mean, I feel it. I just feel it viscerally.
Whitney, run around now!
Her forte was the big power ballad, very high octane, almost a bit hysterical. And I think she sort of invented the school of vocal gymnastics that later Mariah Carey and Celine Dion sort of took up.
You look at this extraordinary series of facial contortions, trembling lips, eyes rolling in the back of her head. She's either going to have an epileptic fit or she's going to get to number one.
It's more than a notion just to stand up and sing, honey. It's all about from coming from here to here to here to here, and it's about control, and I have learned that, I think, pretty well.
The carefully controlled image attracted a host of supposed celebrity suitors in hot pursuit of the woman who'd become the antithesis to Madonna.
She had a certain subtlety and innocence
that you could never credit to someone like Madonna or even to Cyndi Lauper. And that's why Whitney Houston became so big so quickly, because it was such a radical turnaround from the female pop stars of that time.
She was notoriously critical of Madonna and has come out and criticised the way Madonna looked and the way she behaved.
I think Madonna would have seen Whitney as incredibly bland. She might have been jealous of her voice, but I think Whitney didn't have very much edge to her, and Madonna did.
She exuded a sort of little girl ingenue that everybody found extremely attractive. Whether that was the real Whitney Houston, we will probably never know.
And yet we kept hearing, oh, but she's really street and she loves to get down and get funky, and there were these rumours about drugs and rumours of a lesbian affair, and it was quite a strange mismatch.
Not anymore. The late 90s Whitney's cool and sexy with a bad boy husband and a few drug allegations, all a long way from the virginal 80s.
It's ironic that now the tables seem to have turned a bit, and it's Whitney who's the bad girl and Madonna who's the nice good mother and loving girlfriend.
Within a few years she married swing beat bad boy Bobby Brown and subverted the whole image. She should have done it the other way around, of course. She should have started all raunchy and kind of cleaned herself up as time gone by. That's what most musicians do, you know. She's done it the wrong way around.
So very emotional. Not unlike our number three.
Oh, hello.
Hi, I'm Chris.
And I'm Neil.
We're the Pet Shop Boys.
On Music Box, and this is our brilliant new video, so watch it.
Yeah.
One of them, Chris Lowe, who was in a permanent catatonic state. You didn't actually know whether he was kept alive by being plugged into the mains or not. And you had the other one, who was Neil Tennant, who was difficult to pin down as much his act as his personality. They were the total opposite of what you expected.
I love you. If you've got four people, it's always harder to move around. It's harder to capture on TV, whereas you could get the essence of the Pet Shop Boys in an instant on television. There are two of them, one sings, one doesn't. Sometimes you're better off dead. There's a gun in your hand, pointing at your head. You think
you're mad, too unstable, kicking in chairs and knocking down tables and around. Everyone was smiling, having a great time. It was the height of Stock Aitman Waterman, a lot of proto-yuppies, and there was Neil Tennant looking thoroughly pissed off, you know, and rightly so.
When you had everybody else indulging in the excitement, the exuberance, or to some people the grossness of the 80s with the money and the cars and the champagne, along came an act that was the total antithesis of that.
In the era of plastic pop and over-the-top consumption, the Pet Shop Boys offered a refreshing and static alternative that had clearly struck a chord with the record-buying public. Prior to finding success in 1985, Neil Tennant had been a journalist, writing about meat products and gerbils before pursuing his real passion with 80s pop Bible smash hits.
He used his kind of pop journalism, if you like, to get to meet all these people and then to study them at close quarters and think, well, if I ever become a pop star, this is what I'll do. And actually, I think they're incredibly media savvy.
He was actually brighter than his own PR handlers. He knew how to play stories and how to gain a real headwind of enthusiasm for almost anything they did.
He left Smash Hits to start the Pet Shop Boys. Everybody thought it was insane because he could have been editor of Smash Hits, and people thought this was like a terrible career move. But of course it proved to be a very good career move.
'87 was a sort of peak year in a way for the Pet Shop Boys, because they'd come off '86, off the first album doing phenomenally well with the Brit Award, the Ivan Novello Award, and then the first single from the new album went straight in at number one. It was one of those times when really things don't get much better.
The Pet Shop Boys were unique. No smiling, no dancing, and songs that spoke volumes to the vacuous late 80s.
What they did, first of all, was to cement to a dance beat some intelligent lyrics. It's very hard to do.
They had personal issues to address and feelings to convey, and they happened to do that to a very contemporary pop, basically because they both love pop music. I think to a large extent their image probably came from not wanting to misrepresent what they did. I mean, Chris wouldn't pretend to be doing things that he wasn't actually doing on a record, so as most of the music was generated electronically in the studio, that meant standing there doing nothing. I took you to a sandwich bar in Soho, where you let me pay the bill, but you just stand behind me with a TV and a keyboard that someone has lent you. You're good at standing still. I'm quite good at singing. They love it, it pays our rent. They saw that they couldn't be teen idols. I think they were too old in 1987, really, at the beginning of their career, to be teen idols. So they had to play some kind of game, if you like, with the audiences. And I think by being sort of aloof, in a way, from the scene, it added to their intrigue, it added to their mystery, it added to their coolness. Me, I love you quite as often as I could. To like the Pet Shop Boys meant that, you know, you were sort of one step, you know, you were part of an elite, and I think they played on that quite well. You are always on my mind. You are always on my mind.
Despite their origins in the working class northeast, the Pet Shop Boys displayed an almost public school sense of Englishness. The education, the sense of style,
the homosexuality. Yes.
Meanwhile, on the other side of the pond, they were kicking it old school till they brought it over here and got an old school kicking. Do you want a cup of tea, babe?
This speech is my recital. I think it's very vital. To rock around, that's right, on top. It's tricky, it's tight. Here we go. It's tricky to rock around, to rock around, that's right, on time. It's tricky.
In 1987, hip-hop went mainstream. Run DMC were here on tour, and their support act, the Beastie Boys, stole the show. The Brit Press Corps couldn't get enough of their bad boy antics, and even made some up for them.
You had a feeling there was something sort of brewing up, rather like the Sex Pistols created exactly 10 years before.
They weren't so much outrageous as just obnoxious looking. I mean, that was the thing about the Beastie Boys. They were really obnoxious New York street punks.
I think it's a shame that you have to write articles and make up lies to sell your papers. It's really stupid.
Get on stage, the Beasties had inflatable knobs and go-go dancers. Off stage, at least according to the tabloids, they mocked the afflicted. And as for the jewellery, moral outrage in Middle England as the nation's youth vandalised cars in the name of fashion.
The thing that made me really angry is when I went to Ascot and I felt fairly naked without my badge. I mean, I had some pretty fun friends of mine looking at me as if I was mad.
Before we return to our countdown, it's time now to bid a teary so long some of the great icons that left us in 1987.
Having just directed a video for Curiosity Killed the Cat, a career high, gallbladder complications killed modern art legend Andy Warhol. Another celebrity loss was Fred Astaire. Las Vegas piano botherer Liberace also kicked the bucket. Small furry animals everywhere breathing a sigh of relief. Except one, most tragic of all was the demise of a Blue Peter icon, Shep.
I've got some very sad news. He died on Saturday.
Oh.
And I'm over it.
In the year 1987 at Brentford Nylons, just £12.99 could get you this lovely duvet cover, so you could spend every night in bed with Madonna.
Madonna,
what's the new single like?
The old one.
When she arrived in town in London for the concert, and all the journalists were waiting around, it was total and utter mass hysteria. It was like the days of the Beatles all over again.
By 1987, Madonna was a superstar. There was simply no question that she was one of the most important pop music artists in the world.
The summer of 87, Britain comes to a standstill to kneel at the altar of Madonna. But only 3 years earlier, her first visit had barely caused a ripple.
She was taken as this club kid scamp. There was a sense that she was somebody who was going to be disappearing in a moment or two, but in fact, she was the future.
When she first came over to the UK, she played the Camden Palace for a 20-minute set in 1984, did the Tube from the Hacienda, and played the Beetroot Club in Soho. She comes back and she does Wembley Stadium for 2 nights, completely sold out. I mean, there's no middle ground with her.
In Fleet Street and Wapping, the big guns were mobilized as wheezing news hounds tracked Madonna's every move.
When she came to this country, it was quite amazing because I've never seen so many journalists get so fit so quickly, because she would go out on these daily jogs to Hyde Park, and you'd get the fattest, the most drunken journalists sort of trying to keep up with her.
She turned it into a daily media event by going for a jog every day. So you would literally be there very early in the morning to catch her going into Hyde Park with, of course, you must have the personal trainer, the chef, a couple of assistants, her own PR. I think at the height of it, Madonna had about 12 people running with her. God knows what they did. Perhaps one of them was chanting as they went through the park. I've no idea. But it just added to the entourage and the craziness of the whole event.
Whilst Madonna and her Imperial Guard were pounding the pavements, her money-making machine was in full swing.
Madonna put together a kind of media team, you know, so that it's not just about her. It's about her and the producer, her and the video director, her and her various collaborators.
The skill of Madonna, and indeed her people, was that her sense of commercialism was absolutely all-embracing.
Madonna marshaled all of those forces like a military commander. Last night I dreamt of San Pedro. Just like I'd never gone, I knew the song. Young girl with eyes like the desert. It all seems like yesterday, not far away.
With three smash hits and a sellout tour, everything was going to plan, almost. There were two things that even Madonna couldn't control: her eyebrows and her husband.
I specifically don't want to discuss Sean and how he handles himself. He is a grown man and he makes his own decisions about that. And when he wants to talk to the public about it, he can do that, but I don't want to.
I don't see that marriage as anything that had to do with image making. I think it was very real, you know, problematic, you know, fraught with all kinds of problems, but, you know, as real as relationships are.
These were two very fiery, very fiercely individual characters who were either going to slug it out in a barroom brawl or they were going to marry each other. Now, unfortunately, they decided to marry each other, and we all know the rest is history.
Hollywood wild man Sean's hobbies at the time, rumoured to feature violence and booze, led to a brief spell inside and added yet more column inches to the myth that is Madonna.
MTV, Madonna, and the kind of glittery culture of the 80s, the money, the high life, all of those things really all came together to create who Madonna is. You know, 1987 represented kind of the apex of that.
There's no question that Madonna was of the 80s and the 80s were of Madonna. In a way, stars don't have to be as big to get to be number one. I'm sure the competition is as intense as it was then, but to be a Madonna, you get one of those every 25 years.
So if Madonna only made number two, which legend could have possibly held her back from the top slot? Before we find out who, here's a reminder of all those that were denied 1987's ultimate prize.
At 10, the ego has landed. It's Terence. Thumb. It's level 42. At 8, Mel and Kim. F***ing lovely, mate. He wants your sex now. It's George at 7. Repossessed by the spirit of the dance, 5-star at 6. Shrop Rockers to Pow at 5. Giving it some welly, Whitney at 4. No movement at 3, the Pet Shop Boys. And looking like a Gallagher sister at 2, Queen of Pop, Madonna.
And so to our number one, final and emphatic proof that you should never judge a blockbusting, best-selling book by a mimsy, uninspiring cover.
We're having our gigantic in-store warehouse and parking lot sale with hundreds of items here.
On the 8th of August 1987, the world tuned into a new voice, a new sound set for global domination. But things were not as they seemed.
Other laundry pairs start as low as $4.78.
When he got behind the mic, I couldn't believe the voice that came out. I mean, I thought it sounded very black, like Luther Vandross.
It was a culture shock to everybody when it turned out to be a white singer. Not only a white singer, but a northerner with ginger hair.
It's a big man's voice and a little boy's body. Very odd. We're no strangers to love.
And he opened his mouth, and this thing came out of his mouth, and he went, that's not him singing, that's Barry White singing, and Barry White couldn't turn up for the video, so they got the runner who goes for the sandwiches.
The humble northern lad, young Rick, had been singing local songs for local people in working men's clubs under the watchful eye of crack Cheshire management team Tony and Dave. Before, a passing Pop Svengali discovered him and dragged him to London's famous Hit Factory to put the kettle on.
I discovered him at a local Christmas fair up in Newton the Willows, which is where I lived. He was this clean-cut, smashing bloke from the northwest, the kid next door that your mum wanted to look after and give him a sandwich because he looked a bit hungry.
The idea of bringing Rick Astley down to work with us as a T-boy was really basically to bring him out of his shell because he was so retiring.
Come 7 o'clock. Most of the studio staff go home. Rick would then go into the studio with the equipment and start doing his own bits and bobs.
And we got him in every now and again, sing this song, Rick, see how you get on, and gradually introduced him to the idea of singing, you know.
Finally, the copper-top young scamp was ready. His first single was released, and overnight, Rick Astley was big news.
Next thing, bang, number one record. He's invited to every party in town. He's wondering why people are giving him free things like drinks and everything else. He's getting photographs taken from everywhere.
Oh, it was just lunacy. We'd gone from, like, he'd gone from the kid from the garden centre in Newton the Willows to, like, Mr. Personality.
Are you surprised at how quickly everything's happened?
Well, not how quickly, but I am surprised, really, that from such a small town, you can get recognised.
Everybody loved Rick's style. Almost.
That's never quite so easy.
I think it's incredibly difficult. And I think there's one thing, if I can be slightly negative, and that's he's got to look at his performance. And he's got to change and become more positive in his image and his carryover of the song.
Ignoring Simon Our-Tune Bates, the world came together in loving our Rick's groovy moves.
It was a mannerism he had. He sort of does this. And when we went to America, you know, the Americans were actually shouting out, do your little dance, do your little dance. Now, I don't think Rick ever realised that that was an amazing gimmick.
I mean, he's not, I think by his own admission, the greatest mover.
I think if he could have just had his voice on stage and that was it, he would have been very, very happy.
Rick Astley was Rick Astley. People all say, great image, but that was Rick. We didn't put him with style gurus and and think about it, it was all just so natural. That was Rick.
The quiff did eventually get bigger and bigger and bigger till he nearly fell over, but the hairstyle was definitely Rick. No one did that, and no one styled him, really. That was just Rick. He was always a smart lad.
He had the biggest quiff since Elvis, and we liked that. That was what we liked. Rick had amazing, phenomenal, gigantic success in a very short space of time.
People tend to forget just how big Rick Astley actually was. I mean, he was worldwide. Everywhere you went in the world, you know, they played Rick Astley.
Despite the success, the cracks had started to show in Rick's relationship with Stock Aitken and Waterman.
I think I have achieved quite a lot, you know, with the short amount of time. Having said that, it is something that has been sort of very produced and what have you, because, as I say, working with Stock Aitken Waterman, that's what they do best, you know, produce for people, write for people. But I think it would be nice to perhaps start taking a little more control in what I'm doing and working with different kinds of people, you know.
It's fair to say that Rick wasn't entirely happy with doing the sort of music that we had planned for him.
When I fall in love, it will be forever, or I'll
18 months at the top, a new wife, a new baby. Then the unthinkable happened. Rick quit.
He reached a point where he decided that he couldn't go off to America and do another tour. He just couldn't do it. He had his life, he had his wife, his baby, and he didn't want to do that anymore.
It ended before it's begun, and too many moonlight.
He drove towards the airport, and he just said, he stopped the car, I need to get out. So we got out, I was going to be sick. And he said, look, I know you can make me, but I don't want to get on the plane. If I get on the plane, I'm going to die. So he'd lost heart in the whole of it, to be honest, at that point. And, yeah, so I think it would be fair to say that it all came about at the same time, and probably, you know, intentionally, really.
You know, Rick's one of those people that just gave it away. He just stopped and just said, not for me. Right at the height. And as, you know, people look at other artists like Simply Red and say, you know, they were big. He outsold them 2-1. But he just walked away and went, not for me. Don't want this anymore.
She's taken my time, convinced me she's fine, but when she leaves, I'll be so sure, it's always the same.
A couple of years later, there was one final hairy hit before Rick faded back into the scenery.
I bet he's on cruise ships now, isn't he? I hope he's doing all right, because I'm never going to give you up. I still think it's a cracking record.
I don't think we'd even begun to scratch the surface of the potential for Rick. He could still be going now. He could be probably this country's only major international male singer to have been produced since Tom Jones or something.
No matter where I go in the world, the one question that I always get asked more than any other question is, where is Rick Astley?
And the moment...
Where indeed? Having turned his back on superstardom, Rick remains the Lord Lucan of pop. And for now... that's the way he wants it.
At the moment, he's doing what he needs to do. He's got his anonymity back. And I think he feels at the moment there's no point in him coming and sitting in front and talking to people, because there's not a lot to say.
Rick Astley, pop star number one. Legend, and anagram of the phrase tickly arse. Well, while Rick runs around his flat going, in your face, Madonna, and you think about whether to put the kettle on or not, I'm going home. Ta-da.
Trouble in Hawaii for the Osbournes tomorrow at 11:35. Next tonight, inspired by Hollywood's Witness, starring Harrison Ford, we're off to Bollywood, the premiere of the thriller, Up.